the contract between Mr. Paris and his company, Professional Financial Services, Inc. I gave you all copies of those documents in Independence Square, Hero Square, sorry, last year, you remember? That and another one called Bradley, remember? This contract was signed on the 15th of May, 2005. It is signed, it is between Professional Financial Services, Paris' company, CLICO Holdings Barbados, and CL Financial Limited. That is the parent company in Trinidad. Mr. Paris signs it, that's his signature there. Mr. Thompson witnesses it. Mr. Thompson was not yet Prime Minister, he was a lawyer. Address 10A Max Center. Mr. Dupre, the big man from Trinidad, he signs on behalf of CL Financial, and Gail Preston, who works at Thompson and Associates, she witnesses Mr. Dupre's signature. And Mr. Thornhill signs the document, that signature there at the end, on behalf of CLICO Holdings Barbados, and a young lawyer, Ms. Stewart, who at the time worked at Thompson and Associates, she's no longer there, I believe, witnessed Mr. Thornhill's signature. So all three witnesses came from the same law firm. So all this was dead. Who bring it alive? Who bring it alive? The PAL. Now clearly, the feelings that the Prime Minister got for him, he don't have for the Prime Minister. But if not, he would not have read this contract under the light of day at all.
Make you a rum. Make you a rum.
But if that was not bad enough, this is what you call a sweetheart contract. A sweetheart contract. Under clause 14, the employer will pay to Professional Financial Services and Leroy Paris a gratuity of $5 million US dollars on the 15th day of May 2008 in such manner as may be agreed between the parties on terms as set out but amended herein as to the date of payment, but in no way otherwise in a letter dated the 5th of December 2002 between Leroy Paris and Lawrence Dupre. So what that clause at clause 19 is telling you, that CLICO can fire Paris, can fire Professional Service, Financial Services, that if Paris is guilty of grave, not just misconduct, but grave misconduct, he won't get no damages, but he must get all of the $10 million in gratuity. That if Paris willfully neglects, and I don't know whether that includes exposing the company to further liability by selling 2,000 more policies when the supervisor of insurance tells you not to sell. Now even if he willfully neglects to do something, or he does something contrary to the company's policy, or contrary to the law, that whatever happens, $10 million is assured. Now I ask you this. You understand why I say to you that this is a sweetheart deal for any worker? So that when he sues now for the $6.5 million, he is telling you all, how dare you? How dare you stop me from getting my balance of $6.5 million? Because these gentlemen who signed this contract, myself, Dupre, and Thornhill, and he witnesses to the contract, the former Prime Minister, Gail Preston, and Ms. Stewart all agree that whatever I do, that 10 million is assured. It's mine. Mine. That's true, you only can say all is mine. And it is up to you now, the public of Barbados, to tell him not this time. Do you understand what is going on? So the people who have a 50,000, a 25,000, a 100,000, even a 200,000, 300,000. There are people working in public service as a senior public servant can get 150,000, 200,000 in maturity after 35 years. And then you will be up in there soon. But after 33 years, that is the kind of money that you will get coming out of the public service. You take up your money in good faith, you put it down. But I want you to pause and reflect on something. What kind of company could dream about giving somebody in the context of Barbados a $10 million gratuity on top of $80,000 a month? What made money for them? There weren't drilling oil in Barbados. They were using ordinary people's money. Our ordinary people's money became the bank to pay this kind of excessive compensation package. To buy an $18 million plane. Or else to lease a plane for $18 million. To have Mercedes, and it's not that anybody grudges them that. But the question is, if I take your money to get a return for you, I must owe you a higher duty of care that you can get back your money. If he comes and has done well, power to you, skipper. But you can't do well on the backs of ordinary Barbadians who are being barbarized today. And I'm not going to let them change the argument. I'm not interested in DDGRF. I am interested in the fact that you have 2,000 people almost in Barbados and the Eastern Caribbean who are owed over $500 million in executive flexible premium annuities. And you know why I say $500 million? Because CLICO's management accounts would want to tell you that it's $459. But remember, Ernst & Young did a report too? Yeah. And the Ernst & Young report is $50 million higher. So we don't even know what the real figure is. What it says is that if the only writ Mr. Parrish filed was for the $6.5 million, you would say, what an unconscionable man. But he's filed for $750,000. For providing the management services in 2008, 2009, and the first half of 2010. He has filed for the annual bonus of another $300,000 per year, so that's another $750,000 for annual bonuses 2008 to 2010. That is $1.5 million in bonus and management services. A total of $6.5 remaining on the gratuity and the full. In the words of Buju, has not yet been told. And he has filed for his two policies that he had, which have now, he claims, matured. And those two policies come up to $3.6 million. So you add 6.5 plus 1.5 is 8 plus 3.6. Almost $12 million. Now he... He has filed for $12 million. But do you know that if CLICO was to pay $8 million, everybody, the 308 people, having $50,000 or less, would all be paid out for people in law.
Yes.
So 12 million is 1.5 times what the government or the company would need to clear off the 308 people who have $50,000 or less. Now, if you have money, you ain't gonna put a 50. You're gonna put in 100, 200, half million, a million. When a man puts in 50, that's what he got. That's what he got to risk. And he needs that, or she needs that more than anything else. But he would now want his $12 million in claims to come before the 308 people for whom the company would need $8.4 million, not 12, to give them back the full $50,000. 308 families. Do you understand what we're dealing with? How long is too long? How long, you keep the chorus going. How long is too long? And the reality is that in June of last year, Mr. Thompson told us we did not need the judicial management because I have the oversight committee. The judicial management, as I started to explain to you, is ready to conserve things. But what happens when it's conserving things? It makes sure that there can be no dilution of assets. In other words, CLICO can pick up this building here, or this car here, or this property here, and just sell it off. The plane, all of the assets. And we know that they had many assets, many high-valued assets, from Mercedes and planes right back down to properties. Have those, are all of them still there? Have they been sold? If so, to whom? Secondly, judicial management is to make sure that I don't pick out Miss Gill and treat her good and leave out Nigel and treat him bad when both of their policies mature at the same time. You understand what I'm saying? Now, we have no way of knowing it. What we did know is that for the period of time, the 13 months, that the Oversight Committee existed, and God bless the courage of William Lane as a true public servant of this country. And for those who would want to see him, I have never known Mr. Lane to be BDGRF. Down the line. Lick up people in the Labour Party too, lick up people in the Dems too. Not a man, he's not a frightened man. And we need more of them in the public service of Barbados. Straight down the line.
But what?
And the Minister of Finance now must tell us if he has kept oversight over every payment made by CLICO since the 1st of July 2010 until today. Today's date is what? The 20th of March 2011 and continuing. And if he put an arrangement in place to receive every payment, were there payments that if the government's MOU with CLICO was still in place, were there payments that would be in breach of that government MOU that you put in place? In other words, were there payments for dividends? Were there payments for bonuses? Were there payments for gratuities? Payments that during the period of the 12th of May 2009 and the 30th of June 2010 were prohibited and banned payments in breach of the MOU. The Minister of Finance must tell us that. But the Minister of Finance also tell us if they received details of payments after the MOU finished on the 30th of June, and are still receiving, was he aware of any payments to Mr. Parris on the 31st of August 2010 as a part payment of his gratuity? Was he aware of a payment to Mr. Parris on the 28th of September 2010 as another payment, part payment for gratuity? Was he aware of another payment by Mr. Parris on the 22nd of October 2010 as part payment of a gratuity? Because in fairness, he was not Minister of Finance for the first two payments, but he was Minister of Finance for the third. That was the day before the Prime Minister died. And was he aware of a fourth part payment of gratuity to Mr. Parris on the 24th of November 2010? So we're talking about less than 3-4 months ago, you know. And you know that this thing has been going on for how long? When I heard Mr. Parris is alleged to have said, Mottley can have the check, but Obama got the money. Now that is the kind of arrogance. But the woman who owns her house in Chancery Lane, who may be having difficulty in paying because she's no longer getting the interest from her deposits at CLICO, she is not being punished with laughter, she is being punished with hardship. Or the other man, they said, Michael, who has come to me, whose businesses, some of them have virtually have imploded. He is not being punished with laughter. He is being punished with hardships.